Professor Agarwal is a PhD in economics and has specialized in urban traffic transport planning. He served as professor of economics at IIT Delhi for several years. During his long tenure at IIT Delhi, he held coordinatorship of the Applied System Research Program, Department of Electrical Engineering, IIT Delhi, for 4 years. Professor Agarwal has been the BIFR Special Director, Public Representative on the Board of Directors of the Delhi Stock Exchange as a nominee of the Ministry of Finance, Emeritus Fellow of the AICTE, and Visiting Professor at NSIT. He is presently the Chairman of the Committee appointed by the Ministry of Road Transport to review the RTC Act 1950. He is also the President of the Association for Transport Development in India and President of IIT Delhi Retired Employees Welfare Forum. I welcome Professor A.L. Agarwal.
Thank you very much. The transport sector is my interest area. Therefore, I would like to concentrate only on the transport side. Well, the integration is needed for whole of the economy. By integrated approach, I therefore understand and emphasize the integration of transport systems with the overall needs of the society. This needs to be supplemented by an implementable action plan as how, by whom, and when this integration would be achieved. Further, the national transport policy should prepare the integrated transport policy for the country and lay down the guidelines for the complementarity action by the state governments into their sphere. However, the state governments should have the opportunity of reflecting their own priorities while ensuring complementarities with the national transport policy. The objective should be to promote complementarities in respect of contents, phasing, financing, and regulatory framework. That is, an integrated transport policy should address to the real-life problems and needs of today and tomorrow. Besides, the integrated transport policy should take care of the transport needs of the villages, hill, border, and tribal areas of the country. Such an integrated transport policy is yet to be evolved in India. The Planning Commission brought out an integrated transport policy, ITP, in 2001. The ITP 2001 did not provide any concrete strategy of achieving its laudable objectives. Neither there was any follow-up action by the Planning Commission or the government to formulate the action plan to achieve the laudable objectives of the ITP 2001. Besides, there are frequent differences and policy statements on integrated transport policy in the 11th five-year plan and policy documents of the government. The government statements focus on the objectives of the policy and the problems of transport sector, but no concrete plan of action is suggested as how the objectives of policy would be achieved. There are transport policy reports, such as the National Transport Policy Report, NTPC 1980, National Urban Transport Policy 2005, National Auto Fuel Policy, Draft National Road Transport Policy, it is at the draft stage, and the ITP 2001. A recent study on traffic and transportation policies and strategies in urban areas in India was brought out in May 2008 by the Ministry of Urban Development, Government of India. Also, National Urban Renewal Mission, NURM, Golden Quadrilateral, GQ, North, South, East, West, Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, Midterm Review of the 10th Five-Year Plan, the approach paper to the 11th plan titled towards faster and more inclusive growth, November 2006, and the report of the Committee on Infrastructure Development headed by our PM. All these policy documents are no doubt very meaningful, but do not present an integrated approach to the transport sector of the country. I would like to quote an important statement on transport sector from the ongoing 11th Five-Year Plan 2007-2012. The statement is, it is necessary to foster the development of the transport of various transport modes in an integrated manner that will lead to the realization of an efficient, sustainable, safe, and reasonably balanced transportation system, where each mode of transport operates in its field of economy and usefulness with competitive and non-discriminatory prices that are adequate to support progressive development of transport infrastructure services. This would also enable the comparative advantages and economic efficiencies to be properly reflected in the user costs. Chapter 9, page 279, 11th Five-Year Plan. But the 11th plan document is silent about how this integration would be achieved. There is no follow-up action. Indeed, the plan document goes on describing each transport sector, but there is no mention about how the integration would be achieved. The same is true about the ITP 2001. ITP approach was reflected in the 10th plan, 2002-2007. This is the only ITP policy that is available today. Since ITP is my today's theme, I would like to mention some of the recommendations of the ITP 2001 for your feedback. The ITP has analyzed, no doubt, different modes, identified the real transport bottlenecks, and made recommendations for transport systems. The recommendation of railways focus on cost-based pricing, subsidies on social considerations, energy planning, streamlining power tariffs, stopping of cross-subsidization by creating intermediate class for passengers, automatic indexing of fares to increases in fuel and wage costs, building of database, and appointment of an independent tariff regulatory authority for determining railway fares. The recommendations made in the ITP do not reflect the details of the strategy and how the needed integration of transport systems into the various sectors would be achieved. There is also no follow-up action at the government level at the moment. I again quote an assertion from the ITP 2001. The ITP indicates the broad direction in which policies in each mode must evolve. Detailed plan targets or priorities for each mode be outlined in successive plan documents, page 4, paragraph 3.2 of the plan. The ITP should have worked out an evolved and integrated transport policy framework with a strategy and action plan to integrate various modes and facets of transport to meet the requirements of the economy. The ITP 2001 is silent on this. The Government of India is now in the process of preparing an integrated transport policy document for the nation. Let us wait for the outcome of this policy. In my assessment, lack of an implementable integrated transport policy is largely attributable to transport bottlenecks in urban and village India. In urban India, overcrowding and clogging of traffic, accidents, and pollution are observed in cities. The overcrowding at the airports and congestion in air cause avoidable delays. Railway stations in cities are overcrowded, and long delays in getting tickets, arrival, and departure of trains have become the way of life. Seaports are overcrowded, causing delays to the ships to load and unload the freight. The villages, hill, tribal, and border areas lack connectivity and accessibility to their place of livelihood, education, medical care, marketing in particular, and the mainstream of national life in general. In Delhi, sir, we have National Capital Region, NCR. We have built large commercial complexes like Nehru Place, Rajendra Place, Netaji Subhas Complex. People have to commute from long distances to work in these complexes. If work-cum residential self-contained complexes are built on the outskirts of the city, far off from each other and connected by MRTS, then the overcrowding and clogging of traffic in the cities can be minimized to a great extent. The self-contained complex at Dialbagh justifies this approach to urban land use transport planning. IITs are also models of self-contained complexes. Delhi urban land use planning is not judicious. It's unfortunate. These days, large number of very high-value transport projects are undertaken, and high-capacity green buses are added in Delhi. The area in and around games are getting the highest priority. This will create developed and undeveloped regions in Delhi. The quick response and cost-effective transport solutions are available, but are not receiving adequate attention. Delhi is bound to face transport bottlenecks because of lack of integrated transport policy, which I have been emphasizing for the last more than two decades. Again, I'm saying, so far the transport sector has been viewed as confined to providing physical facilities like better roads, better vehicles, and modern ports. But interlinked are many issues, sir, such as subsidies, tariffs, externalities, and which have generally given a go-by. And this has proved detrimental to the society. Transport has several components, and a holistic approach has been missing all throughout. Why is an integrated transport policy required? That some of the points that I would like to place before you. Demand for passenger and freight transport is not an original demand. It but is a derived demand. Thus, no one travels for the sake of traveling. Economy demands that transportation wherever required should be most efficient mode of transportation. Third, transportation creates large amounts of positive and negative externalities. Passenger transport has to discharge a social obligation. It should be affordable to the economically weaker sections of society. Transport consumes scarce natural resources. These resources have to be used in the best interest of the society. Transport is heavily dependent on infrastructure. Taxes on transport are a major source of revenue for the government, but a problem for the growth of the transport sector, detrimental to the transport sector. The transport sector comprises diverse modes and touches upon various facets of society. The transport policy should seek to achieve an optimum mix of all the modes and their integration with the various sectors and facets of the economy. The integrated transport policy should address promoting the modes of travel best suited for a particular requirement, shifting traffic to more environmentally friendly modes of transport, changing transport pattern through use of fiscal tools, improving efficiency of each mode of transport, enhancing safety and security is a major concern these days in the travel. Security is a big travel now problem. Promoting use of new technologies, laying down guidelines to decide the best option for transport, transport demand management, addressing issues of equity in transport, internalizing the externalities, integrate national and regional transport planning into the developmental process, giving the non-motorized modes their due share, clearly defining the role of the private sector. Various acts and laws of the government should focus on integrated transport policy at the national and state levels. Now let us examine as to how this integrated transport policy should be formulated. If we analyze the structure of the government of India, we find a very fragmented approach, a very disorganized approach. Railways are dealt with by the Ministry of Railways. Air transport is the responsibility of the Ministry of Civil Aviation. Water transport is handled by the Ministry of Shipping. Transport and highways, road transport is dealt with the Ministry by the Ministry of Road, Transport and Highways. Besides, a large component of the functions impacting transport fall within the domains of the state governments. Therefore, the first step in developing an integrated approach would be to create an integrated Ministry of Transport at the apex level, to integrate various ministries into one. If this is not possible, there should be at least an effective high-power coordinating mechanism at the apex level. Without this structural change, transport sector would be perceived by each department and organization with its own agenda, and we would never get an optimal mix. Now I would like to mention briefly the urban transport policy. It should focus on priority to public transport, bringing about a more equitable allocation of road space with people rather than with vehicles as its main focus, and increasing greater use of public transport. Multiplicity of agencies and need for a unified agency to handle urban transport systems, institutional mechanism for enhanced coordination, safety and security of transport system be evolved. Can you show the table? Can you display the table? The table. Just see the table here that I have, for the sake of illustration, I have taken only Delhi, Bangalore and Mumbai. See, so many activities are there, but so many more than that agencies are there in all these three towns. And these three agencies, all these agencies are legally constituted. Their powers cannot be merged. These cannot be merged. They have to exist in their present position and to regulate the various activities of the transport sector. And this is the multiplicity part. Now, the National Commission, 1988, identified 16 agencies which regulate transport systems in Delhi. It is therefore not an easy task to merge or the various agencies or their powers. Mere creation of an agency to unify the multiplicity of agencies will not serve the purpose, sir. An unified agency, in order to be effective, should have overriding powers by its constituents. The apex unified agency should take an integrated view of the transport sector. As mentioned earlier, sir, the unification of ministries, regulating transport systems, or evolving a high-power mechanism backed by power needs to be evolved. Further, I would like to mention that the National Commission on Urbanization recommended the setting up the Unified Metropolitan Transport Authority, UMTA. So it was done in 1988. Now we have 2009. We are in 2009. About two decades back, UMTA was pursued in Delhi. It was debated. Well, I became the point of controversy. I was against UMTA. I said UMTA is not feasible to unify DDA, MCD, all the authorities regulating the traffic police and the different agencies. Cannot do it. No, you are against. I said, all right, go ahead. A legislation was passed in Delhi Assembly to constitute AMTA. AMTA was again mentioned in the National Urban Transport Policy brought out by the Ministry of Urban Development recently, but it is not possible. Now they say it's an addition, it's a liability on the government. Why you want to repeat again and again? And if you do not want to listen to the truth, then better you do whatever you like, face it. After 2 decades, we don't see AMTA in Delhi. So it's an agony that I'm sharing with you. It also reflects, now I have mentioned this, the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, Government of India, is in the process of amending the Motor Vehicles Act further. And the Road Transport Corporation Act, 1950. I am the chairman of this committee. It's a very high-powered committee. We have made some recommendations. I have recommended a transport regulatory authority at the national level and given the structure also. Now we have to present to the government, to the ministerial group. If it is accepted, it will go to the cabinet, then it will go to Lok Sabha for approval, and then it will come into force. There are other measures that we have suggested, which I can't divulge now. I'm sorry for it. It will come in due course within 6 months' time before you. It is expected the Transport Regulatory Authority at the national and state level might be suggested in these amendments of the Motor Vehicle Act and the RTC Act to regulate transport sector in an integrated manner. We have done it. Integrating land use and transport planning. Urban transportation as an important parameter needs to be integrated at the urban planning stage. Besides, integrated land use and transport planning in all cities be effectively implemented to minimize travel distances and to improve access to livelihood, education, medical care, and other social needs, especially for these marginal segments of the urban population. As mentioned earlier, such an integrated policy does not exist in Delhi. Capacity building, making concerted efforts on continual basis for developing and strengthening capabilities in the transport sector at the state and city levels to address various issues and undertake the task of developing sustainable urban transport systems. Sir, we have constructed first phase of BRT, Bus Rapid Transit System, in Delhi. It has not succeeded. Then we constructed second phase of BRT, not succeeded. Now they are going ahead for the third phase of BRT in Delhi under the National Urban Renewal Mission, because they have larger funds for these projects. Conceptually, this is all right. BRT is a very good one, but practically it is not working. It is totally a debt investment. Integrated urban public transport system, enabling the establishment of quality-focused multimodal public transport system that are well integrated, providing seamless travel across modes. So it is claimed in Delhi that such a seamless transport system exists at Kashmiri Gate. It is not. So many people ask me, no, ma'am, it is not. I don't have time to expel. I told the left-wing governor, I told the chief minister, it is not. It's a misleading statement that you are making. Emphasis on non-motorized transport, encouraging and providing financial and other transport systems to promote the non-motorized modes of transport, addressing environmental concerns by using cleaner technologies and tighter emission norms and safety parameters. So in so many conferences that we have organized under the leadership of respected Professor P.S. Sasangi at IIT Delhi, sir, we have made very meaningful recommendations in this regard. But nobody bothered. Later on, they accepted. When they face the problem, when there is some bottleneck, then they start thinking. Action is initiated in India after the occurrence of a bottleneck. Not before. rational pricing and innovative financing. This involves the issue of affordability versus viability. For the financing, we have also suggested something in our recommendations, in our amendments. The structural changes, as mentioned earlier. Last but not the least, it should be clearly understood that a policy statement does not have the force of law. We can make a policy, announce a policy, but must have a force of law. All such policies need to be backed up by laws, rules, and executive instructions. It should be clearly understood that the integrated transport system at the national state levels is not an end itself, but a means to an end. Further, integrated transport policy is an interdisciplinary approach. An expert interdisciplinary group of professionals can work out such a policy document. Since Sir Dyalbar Educational Institute is very rich in interdisciplinary teaching and research, an interdisciplinary group of professionals from this institute can bring out a realistic integrated transport policy. However, the government support is imperative, and that is available if the group is here. Thank you very much for listening to my random thoughts on an integrated policy. Thank you very much.